Thanks for joining us for this message from our teaching series, Jesus Is. In this series, we're finding a richer understanding of Jesus' identity, purpose, and importance as we answer the question, who is Jesus? If you have been blessed by the ministry of BridgePoint, consider helping to fuel the mission. You can do this safely and securely online at www.bridgepoint.cc/give. Thanks again for joining us, and we hope that you'll prepare your hearts to hear a word from God.
Well, if you have a Bible, go ahead and open it to the Gospel of John. John chapter 1, verse 1. So that's an easy one. If you don't have a Bible, that's okay. We've got Bibles right in front of you on the pews, and also we're going to have the words on the screen right in front of you. We're in a teaching series called Jesus Is Blank, and so far we've been filling in the blanks for the last couple of weeks, and this series is really built off of a time, an encounter that Jesus had, and I would like to read the kind of core verse that's leading us. It's Mark 8:29, and Jesus asked this question. He says, "But you," he asked them again, "who do you say that I am?" We began this series with this big idea that what comes to our mind when we think about Jesus is one of the most important things about us. And we filled in the blank the first week by saying Jesus is more. He's more than meets the eye. He's more than you could ever imagine. That when you look at Jesus, you could spend your life digging into the depths of who Jesus is. And then last week, we discovered that Jesus is the victor. Jesus has been victorious over Satan, over sin, over death. That means that we can live in freedom. That when Jesus has been victorious over those great enemies, that means we can now walk in freedom. And that the victory of Jesus is our victory. And in many ways, Easter is like the culmination of the life of Jesus. And now what we're going to do for the remaining weeks of this series is we're going to go back and just track through different parts of Jesus' life and teachings. And we're reading through the Gospels, which if you don't know what the Gospels are, the Gospels are eyewitness accounts that were written by Jesus' followers. And they wrote them down so that the truths about Jesus could be passed on throughout generations, because there was going to be a time when the eyewitnesses, those who had lived with Jesus and seen Jesus and walked with Jesus, had witnessed his death and had witnessed his resurrection, had been with him the 40 days after his resurrection, had seen him ascend into heaven. There was going to be a time when those eyewitnesses, they were going to pass away. And so God, through his Holy Spirit, inspired them to write down these words. And today we're looking at John's gospel. We're going to look at John chapter 1. But before we get to the gospel, I'd like to read kind of this longer quote. It comes from a guy named C.S. Lewis. Maybe you've heard of C.S. Lewis before. He wrote a book called Mere Christianity. Originally, it wasn't a book. Originally, he would get on the radio and basically read different parts of this. So it was a radio program. Does anybody remember when there was a lot more programs like that where now we just watch everything on TV? But here's the big idea that Lewis is going to present in this quote. He kind of presents us with this idea. Jesus is either a liar, a lunatic, or he's the Lord. He is either a liar, a lunatic, or a Lord, and he is a polarizing figure when it comes to Jesus. Almost everybody wants to say good things about Jesus. People want to say he's a good moral teacher. I mean, Jesus was, you know, he was a nice guy. But what Lewis is going to show us, what he's going to point out to us is Jesus is not simply, he is not simply a good teacher or a good guy. He said and did things that were much deeper than that. And he doesn't leave us the option. This is what Lewis says. And I put the quote up here because it's long, so you can read along with me. Lewis says this, "I am trying here to prevent anyone from saying the really foolish thing that people say about him. I'm ready to accept Jesus as a great moral teacher, but I don't accept his claim to be God. That is one thing we must not say. A man who is merely a man and said the things that Jesus said would not be a great moral teacher. He would either be a lunatic, on the level with the man who says he is a poached egg. Or else he would be the devil of hell. You must make your choice. Either this man was and is the Son of God, or else a madman or something worse. You can shut him up for a fool, you can spit at him and kill him as a demon, or you can fall at his feet and call him Lord and God. But let's not come with any patronizing nonsense about his being a great human teacher. He has not left that open to us. He did not intend to. And then Lewis gives his own conclusion. Now, it seems to me obvious that he was neither a lunatic nor a fiend, and consequently, however strange or terrifying or unlikely it may seem, I have to accept the view that he was and is God. The question that Jesus presented his disciples with is much like what Lewis has done here. He says, when we encounter Jesus, we're all confronted with a question: what do I believe about Jesus? And really, the deeper question is, what I believe about Jesus actually true? I mean, you can believe all kinds of things about Jesus, but the question is whether the things you believe are actually true. Well, today, we're going to discover something about Jesus that is profound. It goes into what even Lewis was saying is his belief that Jesus was and is God. So if you're taking notes, today's sermon title, today's fill in the blank is this: Jesus is life. Jesus is life. And we're going to begin in John chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. We're going to read this and then we're going to pray together. So John's gospel begins like this: in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning, and all things were created through him, and apart from him, not one thing was created that has been created. Life was in him, and that life was the light of men. That light shines in the darkness, yet the darkness did not overcome it. Let's pray together. Father, we believe that this is your inspired word. We believe every word of it is true. We believe that you moved in the heart of the disciple John to write these words down to tell us about who Jesus is. And he wrote so that we would believe in you, believe that you are who you said that you are. And so God, I just pray today that that there would be belief birthed in this place. That God, that maybe someone coming in here that had a deficient view of Jesus or had no view of Jesus, that it will come to see that Jesus is life itself and the depth of what that proclamation means. God, for those of us that have faith already birthed in our heart, I pray for it to grow, for it just to multiply. God, that we will just again be in awe of Jesus. God, even though we sing the name of Jesus and we say the name of Jesus, I pray that today that we will just be in awe of the name of Jesus, that we will just fall at our knees at the glory of the name of Jesus and the truth that Jesus is life and there is no life apart from him. So God, to that end, just move through your Holy Spirit. Help me just to preach as someone that is just on fire. We pray this in your name. Amen. So, John gives us this phrase. He says, life was in him. Now, you may think, what does life mean? Y'all know we use the term life ourselves in a lot of different ways. I mean, we use life meaning just our existence, the fact that we exist here on earth, that you have life. Sometimes we talk about the good life, right? Have you ever seen those shirts? Life is good. And we use it that way. We're talking more about our experience. what life is like and the events that are happening. And in John's gospel, he uses this phrase, this idea of life, over 36 times. 36 times he talks about life, and so many of them, as we're going to see, they're connected to Jesus. And what I want to do in today's message is I want us to when we come back and you read 1 John 1:4 that says life was in him, life was in Jesus, I want from this point forward for your mind just to get filled in with all the ideas that John's trying to communicate to us by proclaiming that life itself is in Jesus. What did he mean to say that life is in Jesus? What does it mean for us to proclaim that Jesus is life? So here's the first thing. Are y'all ready to, this is like jumping off into the deep end of the pool, okay? This is like, I mean, you're jumping off like the high dive into the water. That's where John's gospel begins. And the first thing he means is this, write this down. To say Jesus is life means that Jesus is self-existent life. You're like, that sounds complicated. Well, it is. And it's profound. So when we say Jesus is life, we are saying that Jesus is self-existent life. There's an old Latin word that is aseity. It means life in itself. It means that there is no source of life outside of itself. That is what John begins the gospel by saying about Jesus, is that before anything was, Jesus was. That Jesus existed, that Jesus had life within himself. He is saying that Jesus did not derive his life from anyone else. There's no other source. He's not dependent on anyone or anything. I told you it's the deep end of the pool, right? And so this is how John's gospel begins. Look back at verse 1 with me. John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word. Now, I'm going to stop right there. Does that sound familiar? If you have any knowledge of the Bible, does that sound familiar to any other part of the Bible? In the beginning, okay, yeah, you're right. So all you Bible scholars, you just got it. Genesis 1, so the first verse of the Bible, and if you're not familiar with it, this is what it says. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Scripture begins not by arguing for the existence of God, but by proclaiming the fact of God. Before anything existed, God was. Now, have you, if you're a parent, you might have had your child ask you a question, where did God come from? Any parents had your kid ask? Now, how many of you, maybe you've asked that yourself, where did God come from? Here is the amazing challenge that Jesus presents with us. By John saying that life was in him, by saying that in the beginning was the Word. Now, you may wonder, why does it say the Word? This is the word logos. And in the Greek mind, the logos was what was responsible for the creation of the world. And in the Jewish mind, the logos, they would have thought of the I am statements of God. And so John's beginning his gospel trying to draw in the Greeks and the Jews. He's trying to draw in everybody, and he's trying to say, when you wrestle with life and where life came from, I want you to think of Jesus. I want you to see that before anything was, Jesus was. And we're going to see not just Jesus, but one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So John begins his gospel not where the others do. A lot of the other gospels begin with the birth of Jesus. John begins before anything was. And he makes this profound proclamation. In the beginning was Jesus. Before anything else. You say, what kind of confrontation is that? Well, that already confronts the narrative that our world actually gives about existence, right? Because, you know, you either believe that there is a creator who existed before anything else, had self-existent, and that he breathed and spoke everything into existence, or you're going to have to think of some other explanation. And the other narrative that we have in this world is that at some point something existed and it exploded. But can I just point out something that should be obvious to all of us? Do you realize in both of those cases, you have to believe that something self-existed? Wait, did y'all just get that? Because see, often people, if someone takes an evolutionary view of the universe, we make it seem like that Christianity or the belief in God is based on faith, but that's based on fact. Do you not see that both principles begin with faith? How did that something that exploded, how did it get there? Everybody believes in something self-existent. John begins by saying, Jesus is the self-existent one who had life in himself. He didn't need any of us. There was no source that created Jesus. He just always was. Now, if you cannot quite get your mind around that, it's because it's a mystery. It's because you're dealing with God. It's because you're dealing with someone that is like no other. And so John 1:1 says, in the beginning was the Word. Now notice this. And the Word was, there's going to be two phrases. The Word was with God and the Word was God. You need to underline those two words. With God and was God. Right here at the beginning of Genesis, we see this mystery that's later revealed, that God is a Trinity, that there is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, three persons. That's the reason John says that he was with God, because there is this relational, that for all eternity, God has existed in perfect fellowship, Father, Son, Spirit. Father and Jesus and Holy Spirit. But he's not just simply with God, he is God. Now, there are plenty of people who are okay saying that Jesus is a man. But Jesus nor his disciples have left that option open to us. The proclamation to say that Jesus is life means he's self-existent. It is a way of saying that Jesus is God. So Jesus is not simply, he's not like God, he is God. Now, in one of the early sermons of the church, Paul is speaking to a group of people that they worship lots of different gods. And he begins by, and they had this one idol that said, to the unknown God. And Paul uses that as an opportunity to do something. He uses it as an opportunity to say, I'm going to tell you about this unknown God. You have this one. They're like, okay, we're curious. And this is what he says. This is how he begins. He says, Acts 17:24-25. The God who made the world and everything in it, he is Lord of heaven and earth, and he does not live in shrines made by hands, neither is he served by human hands as though he needed anything. Since he himself gives everyone life and breath and all things. So Jesus, the self-existent one, John begins by saying Jesus is life and life was in him. And that means he did not need a source outside of himself. He is the very source of life. And that brings us to the next thing that John's going to show us. Write this down. To say Jesus is life also means Jesus is the creator of life. The creator of life. Let's look at verse 3. John 1:3. All things were, what's it say? Created through him, through Jesus. And apart from him, not one thing was created that has been created. Here is the profound thing we proclaim that Jesus is life. It means that Jesus is the source of life for everything. There's nothing that you can see or imagine that's in this universe that does not owe its existence to Jesus. So think about every molecule that exists, every atom, every grain of sand, every star, every blade of grass, every bird, every animal, every tree, and every single person. Everything exists because Jesus is our creator. Now that's a pretty profound thing that John is saying. Life is in him. Everything in this universe. When people peer into the stars, you know, there are things that none of our eyes have ever seen and never will see in the vastness of the universe. And we may think, is that wasted space? I mean, we have this idea that somehow that's wasted because our eyes don't see it. And that's only because we think we're the center of the universe. We're not the center of the universe, and it doesn't matter if our eyes see it. The great God who created it brought him glory and honor to create everything. And so he made a decision to say, I don't need anything. God has self-existent life, but I want to. Out of my joy, out of my being, I want to create. And he spoke and brought everything into existence. And even humanity, he breathed breath into us. And it said humanity itself was the pinnacle of creation. And he created us in his image. Isn't that amazing? You know, in some ways, when we talk about ourselves being creative, none of us could ever be creative like God is creative. God's creative in the sense that he takes nothing and makes something. All of us have to work with something, right? So we are like God in that we create, but in many ways he's so above us and so beyond us. That's what it's saying about Jesus is Jesus didn't just come on the scene when he was born to a virgin. We're going to talk about that next week. We're going to talk about how God entered into flesh, how God came and joined us. That's not when Jesus came on the scene. And you know, there's people, see, this idea about Jesus confronts many of the religions of the world. See, lots of people are fine with saying Jesus was a man or Jesus was a created being or Jesus is like a God amongst others. None of those are left open to us. Jesus made these proclamations that he himself was God and his disciples understood him as that. It's also the reason that they ended up killing Jesus because of these claims. So everything that we see is dependent on Jesus. So when we say that Jesus is life, it confronts any kind of naturalistic, impersonal understanding of the universe. That just says that we all got here by chance. That says that we were just this big mistake, this big accident. And if you follow that through, then where is there any meaning for any life? If we're just here by an accident and we're not purposely put here, why does it matter? But see, saying Jesus is life confronts that. It has implications. It means that you and I, that creation itself was personal and it was purposeful and it was meaningful. And your life and my life and every life has meaning. And everything we see, every blade of grass, every tree, every star, everything is an amazement and it's a testimony of the Creator. And when we think of Jesus, that's what we should think of. But here's one of the implications to say Jesus is the creator. It means that Jesus has a claim over everything. Whoa, whoa, whoa. A claim over everything. That means he even has a claim over me and a claim over you and a claim over everything. Y'all do know that this is the reason we try to think of another explanation of the earth that does not have a personal creator, right? It's because we don't want anyone or anything having a claim over us. And if we all got here by an accident, then nobody can be in control of me. But proclaiming that Jesus is life means that I am here because Jesus decided for me to be here. And that means he has a claim. Today's like quote day, okay? I'm just like quote day. So here we go. Here's another quote. I love this quote. This guy named Abraham Kuyper, he says, there is not a square inch in the whole dominion of our human existence over which Christ, who is sovereign over all, does not cry, mine. 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 Jesus is our creator. And he created you. And he created me. And he created all things. He is the one that is the giver of physical life itself. Now, John's not the only one that proclaims this. I just wanted to give you a couple other samples in case you're like, well, does anyone else in the scripture say that? Well, I'm glad that you asked. Colossians 1:16. For everything was created by him in heaven and on earth, the visible, the invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. Wow. You know, he's like, okay, I heaven, earth, visible, invisible, everything. It's been created through him and for him. It means that everything was created ultimately to bring glory to God, to honor him, to proclaim. The psalmist in Psalm 19 says, the heavens declare the glory of God. They proclaim without even using words. Revelation 4:11. Our Lord and God, you are worthy to receive glory and honor and power because you have created all things. Because of your will, they exist and were created. One more. Acts 17:28. This is in that same sermon we just quoted from Paul. For in him we live and move and exist, as even some of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. Paul quotes one of their unbelieving poets to say, look, even this guy knows that this is true. So think about this. To say Jesus is life, you should think Jesus is the reason I have life. He's the reason I exist. He's the reason I'm here. It's the reason I have breath in my lungs. And this is true for all of us. And that means that Jesus has a claim over us. The self-existent one that had life in himself decided to share that life with us. Isn't that amazing? And it didn't take anything away from him to give it to us. Now, here is the predominant thing that John means when he proclaims that Jesus is life. And it's what he spends most of his gospel. Most of those 36 references are referring to what I'm about to say now. Jesus is the source of abundant life. Jesus is the source of abundant life. Well, Jesus himself said this. I think that's a good place to learn about who Jesus is by actually going to Jesus, don't you? Actually hear his words. John 10:10, this is what Jesus says. A thief only comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. I have come so that they may have, what? Life, and have it in abundance. Now, the interesting thing is Jesus says a thief comes to kill, steal, and destroy. If you were here last week, we read this verse, 1 John 3:8, and it says this. It says, Jesus came to undo the works of the devil. You know, killing and stealing and destroying, those are the works of the devil. He came to take the creative work of God and twist it. I don't know if y'all know this, but Satan did not create anything. He's a fallen angel. He's a created being. So the only thing that he could do is take the good things that God had made and call and tempt us to use them in ungodly ways, or to use them to take them out of order. And he does that all the time. You know, I mean, you think about it. He says, okay, let's go back to the garden. He looked at Adam and Eve, and they're naked, and he says, you know, be fruitful and multiply. That's like being a family, right? And so he has this man and this woman, and they're united together, and he says, this is the context for creating life. This is the context for sexual intimacy. And Satan looks at that, and he says, I can't create that, but I can try to screw with it. Okay, so you don't have to be married in order to do that. Just do it whenever you want to. That's no problem. It'll be fine. It'll feel good. It'll be awesome. No problems. I mean, why just choose one person? Why not multiple people? I mean, I know God created men and women to be together, but you know, if you're a woman, just be with a woman. If you're a man, just be with a man. Just do that. It's cool. See, Satan tempted us to take the good gift and to twist it around, right? And ultimately, what we don't realize is that he is stealing and killing and destroying that gift. You could take it with the 10,000 other gifts, right? I mean, you could take it in lots of other areas of life, and you could apply it. I mean, God created food, right? Food's good. You need food. You know what Satan does is he says, oh, just indulge in it. Food is everything. Just eat all you want. Or, oh, no, you're too big. You don't need to eat at all. Like, what I'm saying is he twists up everything, and we could keep going through. And that's what Satan did is he took the life that God had breathed into existence, and then he came and started twisting it and messing up that life so that the life that we experience is a broken life. I don't know if y'all know this, but the life we experience in this world is a broken life. And Jesus comes into that. He steps into it when John proclaims that life was in him, not just that Jesus was self-existent, not just that we exist physically, that we have life and breath, that he created us, but he came to give us this abundant life. He came to undo the works of the devil. He says, I have come so that they may have life and have it in abundance. I came to undo what has been done. I came to restore what has been broken. I came to give life. Now, I want to say a few things about this abundant life. The first thing is, abundant life in Jesus is an eternal life. It lasts forever. It doesn't wear out. Don't you hate when things break and wear out and they get old? You have to buy new things. Your shoes wear out. Your clothes get faded. You run out of things, but abundant life is eternal. John 5:24. I assure you, Jesus would say, truly, truly, this is like, pay attention to this. Anyone who hears my word and believes him who sent me has, what's it say? Eternal life, and will not come under judgment, but has passed from death to life. See, that's the thing is at the beginning of the world when it was created and when Adam and Eve, when they sinned, death entered into the world. And now this experience of death, this brokenness, this intruder is invading in on this abundant life that he had given Adam and Eve. But when Jesus came, he came to say, I'm going to now restore people. I'm going to move you from living in death to now living in life. And it's not just going to be a life that lasts for a little bit. It's going to be a life that lasts through eternity. Do you know when God created us, he created us to be like him? To be in existence and to forever be in existence. People are created to live forever. You and I are created to live forever. And even when our bodies die, our souls are going to live on. And so Jesus has given this promise that you can move from death to life, an eternal life with him. So the first thing is that it lasts forever. It doesn't wear out. The second thing about this abundant life is this abundant life is secure. Listen to what Jesus says. The abundant life is secure. John 10:27-28. My sheep hear my voice. I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they will never perish ever. That's kind of building off of that eternal. But notice this next thing he says. And no one will snatch them out of my hand. Amen. Now, this is a really profound statement. When we come in contact with Jesus and we believe in Jesus and we get connected to Jesus, his life becomes our life. And he says that once we have his life through faith in him, a true faith, a believing faith, the faith that clings to Jesus, that no one can snatch us out of his hand. Now, I want you to think about this. I've heard some people, they hear this verse and they say, well, I could take myself out of God's hand. No, you're someone. No one, not even you. Not even you. I'm glad that I can't wiggle myself out of the hand of God who's held on to me. Because if I did, I would be in trouble and you would be in trouble. So for those that truly have faith in Jesus, we have moved from death to life. We have experienced and moved into this eternal life, this secure life. Life was in him. And we haven't even got into the fact that God is not done with his creating ability. Because he tells us that one day at the end of history, because this world has become broken, that he is going to recreate a new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. It will be a place where only life exists, that there's no death and no brokenness. And that everyone that knows Jesus, everyone that is in Jesus, that our final dwelling place is not up there. He's going to bring heaven down to earth into this new renewed earth. Now think about this. He's going to restore life to everything that was broken. Abundant life. Will there be animals? I think so. Will there be food? I hope so. You'll be able to eat it and you won't even like get big or small or anything, you know? It's just like, it'd be awesome. But you know what? It's going to really make it abundant. And the reason that that life is going to be sustained there is because Jesus himself will be there. You know, that's the greatest thing about it. It's not all that. It's not all the other things. It's the fact that Jesus in his very presence, the very life-giving one, is going to be there. And we're going to be with him. And it's going to be joy. And he doesn't just kind of give life. Think about this. He gives abundant life. Life that overflows. You see, within this world, we sometimes get what I call like a half-life. I think that's what Satan wants to tempt people with, is some of these half-lives, some of these half-truths, where it has the old shell of life on it, except for when you get to the inside of it, it's filled with death. And Jesus said he came to give abundant life. John says that life was in him. The life that Jesus gives is an overflowing life. It's a life that when you get to the core of it, it's not rotten. And how many of us, let's just admit something, how many of us have went down a path thinking something is going to give us life or give us joy, and then we get past the shell of it and we get to the inside, we find out that it's rotten in the inside. And so Jesus comes as the life giver, the one who has life in himself, the one who breathed life into existence, and now he promises this eternal, secure, abundant life. And how do we get to that life? Well, this is really the whole reason that John wrote this gospel. And it's what Jesus himself proclaimed. Listen to what Jesus says about receiving this life. John 11:25. Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the what? The life." This came right after they had found their brother Lazarus was dead. He had been in the grave, and Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life." And in just a moment, he's going to speak, and he's going to say, "Lazarus, come out of the grave. Lazarus, arise." And Lazarus is going to come out like all mummified and stuff, and they're going to like unwrap him, and he's going to be in full health and alive. And Jesus is that life himself. But notice what he says. The one who, three words, believes in me, even if he dies, will live. You know, because of sin and brokenness, this body is going to go into the grave one day. But Jesus pointed us to the beyond the grave. He says there is a life that exists beyond that. That even though physical death may come to you, there is a spiritual life that is given to you. And then eventually, one day, we'll be given new bodies to dwell in a new heavens and a new earth. One more verse just about receiving this life. 1 John, same John, different writing. 1 John 5:11-13. It's our last verse we're going to look at together, last verses. This is the testimony. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Are you going to find this life in another person? No. Are you going to find it in Muhammad? No. Hey, let's do something. Let's do a roll call for a second. Muhammad, are you here? Dead. Buddha? Dead. Joseph Smith? Dad. New Age guru that you want to think of? Gandhi? Dad. Jesus? Here. We could do this for every person. Life is in him. Life is in the Son. So the reason Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. There's no other way to get to life except through Jesus. Verse 12. I'm sorry, I just went off over there. Verse 12. The one who has the Son has life. So if you want to know, do you have life? The question is, do you have Jesus? Is he yours? Do you believe in him? The one who doesn't have the Son does not have life. It doesn't mean that you're not living and breathing, but we're like walking dead people when we don't have Jesus. I have written these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God so that you may know that you have eternal life. So here is the good news. If you are a follower of Jesus, you've come to a point in your life. See, we all come to a crossroads where Jesus says, who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am? For those of us that can look and say, Jesus, I say that you are life. Jesus, you are the only source of life. Jesus, I have death because of my sin, and only you can give me life. Jesus, I believe that. It says for those that have embraced that, those that believe that, those that confess that, we can know that we have this wonderful, abundant, eternal, secure life that Jesus has talked about, that we begin experiencing right now that leads us into eternity. And let me just say to you today, maybe today you're thinking to yourself, that's what I want. I've got to the core of all these other things and found out that they're rotten. I've tried all these other things that promised me to have life, but they didn't lead to life. And maybe you've come to the end of everything. And see, when we come to the end of everything, we're finally ready to come to the only one who can truly give us life. And that's Jesus. And so I want to leave today with an invitation to maybe someone that came in here and you were looking for something and didn't know what you were looking for. Maybe exactly what you were looking for was Jesus and the life that he offers. And the scriptures are clear that if we will confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord, he's the ruler over all, and believe that he was raised from the dead, that he has the power of life even within himself. Death couldn't even hold him down. If you will believe those things, if you will trust Jesus, you will call out to him. What we've been talking about, that life, in a moment, comes inside of you. In that moment, not later. The moment that I believe life came into me, and that secure life, that eternal life, is mine now and forever. And the same can be true for you today. So the invitation is simply this. If you want that life, all you have to do is ask him. Can we stand to our feet? Would you join me just in a word of prayer? Father, we have just heard proclaimed the truth that life is found in Jesus. This self-existent life, this creator life, this abundant life is found in Jesus and Jesus alone. And God, for those of us that have that life within us, I pray that it would just make our hearts beat stronger and the joy just to well up in us and overflow. And that, God, that we would just celebrate this life that we have and just revel in this life and just stand in awe of this life that we have. And God, I pray also for those today that maybe for the very first time are going to reach out to you for life, and that they will believe your promise that you will give life to all that believe in you. God, that promise is true. And I pray that they would just sense that life coming into them as soon as they call out to you and believe in you. And God, I pray also that we would now go out into this world and that we would proclaim life to people that are still walking in darkness. God, you tell us that the darkness does not overcome, but the life was the light of men. And so we leave this place today as light, going out into a dark place so that the world that has death can experience life. We get to be those light bearers, those life bearers. Empower us to do that in our workplaces, in our schools, everywhere we go, in every business we walk into, even in our own houses. I pray that life and light would just be manifest through us. Empower us to that end. We pray this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Let me say to you today, if today is the day that you said yes to Jesus and you prayed for that life in, there's an area at the back that says, I have decided. Either during this song or after this song, before you go, just go back there and say, hey, I chose life today. I got life today. And they just want to celebrate with you and talk to you about your next steps. But church, if you're excited about Jesus, can we just sing this last song together? Have y'all got one more in you? Can y'all do that? Let's sing this together.